right? So the first thing you want to check, it says, is document. So it says check AERO. Now, AERO is an acronym. It stands for Airworthiness Certificate Registration. So just like a car, we have a registration here, and it's good through usually 3 years. So this one's through March 31st, 2022. So that's good. And it is for 8276 ECHO, which is what we are. Airworthiness. This one doesn't expire unless the inspections aren't done on it. You can see this for 8276 ECHO. That's just an airworthiness. So that's the A, airworthiness certificate. R is the registration.
Okay.
O is operating limitations. Operating limitations include all the placards have to be on here. There's like a certain amount of placards.
Is there a list about how many placards should be on?
Yeah, they're going to be in here. And then the other part of it is what we call the POH, or Pilot's Operating Handbook. Every plane should have it, the original one or whatever is approved on here. And it basically has a list of all the stuff, like your owner's manual.
Oh, so it's like the owner's manual for a car.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
So if something's going wrong, this is what you need to check. If these gauges are going haywire, this is what the problem is.
Yeah, right. Talks about all the stuff that's supposed to be on here, what they're meaning in terms, limitations on here. And this will tell you placards over here, so 210.
Control lock, which is going to be this, so you can just pull that thing out.
And you can see there's a little hole in there, and that just keeps the controls locked in there so the wind don't blow them around.
Nice.
Now we're free to move the control surfaces around. You can see ailerons are moving. Elevator in the back's moving. And then we got a check in here. So it says magneto's off. So magneto's are going to be your key, and those are running your spark plugs. They're basically like little generators on there, and we want to make sure those are off because we're going to be turning power on here. All electrical off. Basically all our switches are off. There's nothing that's on. All our switches are off. Circuit breakers are all in. There's nothing that's, you know, popped out like that. Master is going to be that red switch right there. So we're going to say it says master on. So go ahead and click the master on. Now we have our fuel indicators right here, so you can tell. All right, these are ones are saying we're a little short of half a tank on each of them. And we'll check the fuel when we go up there with our stick, see how much fuel we got. Then it says turn coordinator, which is right here. Now if we have it off, see how it has a little orange flag on there? It says off.
Right.
So it's electrically operated. So the moment you click it on, it goes away. And we know that spin up that you hear right there is a gyro spinning inside there.
Okay, cool.
Or spinning up. Flaps are right here. So you can go ahead and put that lever down all the way. And that's moving our flaps down.
So we just check and make sure that they're not going like, you know.
Making no weird noises.
Yeah, exactly. So flaps are all the way down. Then it says lights and pitot heat. So basically what we're gonna do is we're gonna turn all these lights on. So you got pitot heat, nav lights, beacon, strobe, and a landing light. So you're just gonna go ahead and turn all those on. Boom. And then we'll just do a walk around, check and make sure all our lights are working. A ship, right? Ship has port, starboard side. That way you can see them. Hey, if I know that if I see the red on my right side and I see a green light on the left side, shoot, that thing's coming at me.
Right.
Right? Or if I see, a red and a green, it's going away from me. So we have a nav light here. We also have a strobe, and this is actually an antenna. It's a ADS-B antenna that's actually recently installed.
So what's the strobe light for?
strobe light just to kind of draw attention to you, right? Okay. If you see something flashing, that's kind of not a natural, like, solid light.
Right,
it
kind
of draws your attention to you. And we have a beacon up here. Every plane's going to have a beacon on the tail, usually. Somewhere that's going to be flashing, let them know, hey, there's something happening here.
Always the beacon's on the tail.
Usually on the tail, yeah. Sometimes there's a belly strobe and stuff. Tail light, that's part of the nav light, right? So you can see, oh yeah, if you saw like a red and a green and then a white light in the middle, you know that that thing's moving away from you.
So red on the left, green on the right is away. Red on the left, green on the right means it's coming at you?
Well, it's depending on where you're looking from, right? So if I saw a red on the left, green on the right, and then a white light, it would mean that there was, that thing was moving away.
Going away.
But if I was looking at it and I saw red on my right and green on my left, that would say it's coming at me.
Okay.
At nighttime. So again, I'm gonna come over this side. Here's another nav light and another strobe.
Okay, so there's a green one.
There's a green and a strobe. And then we should have a landing light down here. Sometimes they're in the wing, but this one, the light's right here.
Oh, nice. It's like a headlight.
It's like a headlight.
Huge headlight.
Now, we also turned on pitot heat, just in case we got into some conditions where maybe it was gonna start icing up. And you can tell that freaking thing is hot as hell, though. Just watch yourself.
Oh yeah, you can feel it.
All right, let's go and turn off all the
So what does that thing do? So that thing keeps your thing de-iced in case you get into icy weather?
Yeah, so ice is gonna form. Basically, ice is gonna form on any like thing that's sticking out usually first.
Right.
Right, so any like protrusion or something, it's gonna stick on there. And unfortunately, that thing's supposed to stick out there because that's gathering your ram air. So all the air pressure as we're moving through the air is trying to fit through that little tiny hole.
Wow.
And that's what works your airspeed indicator.
Okay.
So that tells you how fast you're going. So if that was to freeze up, then your indicator is not gonna show how fast you're going. So they have a little pitot heater on this plane.
Oh yeah, that thing's small.
Case, right? Just in case this starts to ice up, because it's just a bare metal thing.
Right.
So if you get that thing hot, then that thing won't melt, melt it, right? It won't freeze up and block that hole.
Nice. That's so cool. That's so interesting.
All right, so we turned the lights off. So in the fuel, the fuel's located up here, right? It's in each of the wings. There's a left tank and a right tank. And we could choose which tank we want to run. So we could say, let's run off the left tank.
Right.
Right? Let's run off the right tank. Usually it's in the both position. That way it's drawing both tanks. So fuel's kind of coming down this line, coming down through here, and then going through this fuel selector, and then up to the firewall. Yeah, there's a strainer, fuel filter, and then it goes to the carburetor from there. So this one has four positions. We got both left, right, and then an off position. And so we just kind of check and make sure, oh yeah, it's going into each of its positions here. So we usually just keep it in the both.
And when you're done flying, do you put it back in, or do you put it in the off position, or do you just leave it in the takeoff position?
Yeah, we just leave it in the both positions. Okay. Some places that you'll go to, they'll say run it off the left one because they want to kind of check this valve in here.
Mm-hmm.
But we just keep it in the both position. It never gets moved. So if it never gets moved, then whatever. It's better to have both. But if you notice, like, hey man, I'm like, the right one's draining a little bit faster, right? It's using the right one, and if we're getting kind of loaded up on the left side, then you can run off just off the left side for a little bit to kind of help balance out the wings.
Oh, okay, so this is your gauges for both fuel tanks for the left and
left,
right one.
Left and right. See, right, it's cool. L fuel and R fuel.
Right.
Okay. Now we have our brakes, too. So these are our rudder pedals. So if you notice, if you look in the back, rudder's moving, just pushing the pedals.
Right.
Now the brakes are on the top of the pedal, so if you were to push on the top of the rudder pedals here, it actually works. There's a little master cylinder on each of the ones, kind of like your car, right? You have a brake master cylinder. This one has one on either side. It's just a piston, and you're applying that pressure that you're putting to the top is applying pressure to the brake fluid. The brake lines go down to your main tires here, just to a regular caliper brake disc, just like your car.
Wow.
Hydraulic system, brake fluid, going to the caliper, putting the piston and pushing the pads on the disc.
Right. That's your brakes for your tires for when you're landing or taking off and you don't want to take off. These are the brakes you use.
Yeah. Every plane's going to have brakes so we can kind of move. We use brakes for obviously stopping and also to make sharper turns. So you can turn when we're pushing this. Not only does it work your brake or your rudder back there, but it also turns your nose wheel here a little bit, right? I mean, you'll turn it like 10 degrees or 15 degrees.
So each pedal is for each tire, a left pedal for the left tire, a right pedal for the right tire.
Yeah, it's not like a car where you have one and it works all of them.
Right.
No, this one, the left one is only going to operate the left one. That's the way we have what we call differential braking. So you can actually make a sharper turn by just tapping the brake. And it will kind of stop that one, and this one will keep rolling, and it will pull you over to the side. You'll see when we're taxiing. All right, so now it wants us to go left fuel tank sump. So that's that little drain that's above you right here. See that little one with the little wire sticking off of it?
This little guy right here.
Yeah, so go ahead and stick that little stick up there and drain, like, I don't know, half the fuel. So that's a check. We're just like looking for color, right? So the color should be a bluish tint.
Yep.
Looks like that. And if it had water in there, it would look like salad dressing, like that wasn't mixed. It's like
oil. Like and vinaigrette
water
on top?
Yeah, it's like oil and water. The water will sink to the bottom. Right? And then we also look for sediment or pieces of crap in there.
Nice. So what I do with this now? Just dump it out.
Drink it, bro.
I gotta drink this. This is the first student pilot initiation right here. You have to drink a shot of, gas. Yeah. We'll be awake all night with this.
You know, dump it out on this. This is our left main. So we have a left main, we have a right main, and then we have a nose tire, tricycle gear. This is our left main, so it wants us to check the tire and the brake for any issue. So in regards to tires, just like a regular tire, right, you're looking for major bald spots, usually taking it all the way down to the cord in there, which is just the threading that they have in there. So if you saw that, I would say fix the tire and have them change it. This one still looks like it's good. It's got all the tread. It's wearing pretty evenly. There's not really any bald spots. No big cuts in the sidewall or the top here. Everything looks like it's inflated correctly. Here's our axle nut. So this whole thing spins like this, and you can see it has a little cotter pin to help it keep it from spinning. So things tightened on there, and if you were to take that nut off, the whole pile along the rim and all that stuff. Well, if you had the caliper off. Now on the back side here, we have the caliper. So we said if you push on the left brake pedal, right, it's going to put pressure on this fluid here. And that fluid's going to go inside this caliper, and it has a little piston, and it's going to push these pads together. And then it's just going to pinch this disc. So this disc is attached to the rim, so this is spinning in there, and the moment you push that pressure on there, it tries to, you know, put some friction on there, and it slows you down. So we're just looking for any leaks, right? Because obviously it's fluid, so if fluid was coming out, there'd be leaks. It'd be all wet here, it'd be dripping, this kind of reddish, oily fluid. So we're looking for that. We're looking for just general damage. Width of the pads on there, because your pads obviously wear down, just like your car.
Right.
And anything broken. Everything else looks good right here.
Yeah.
Yeah. I always hang out low.
Yeah, if we were 4 foot, something would be all right.
Yeah.
Bro. Make it.
We ain't.
Unfortunately, I don't think that would qualify for pilot either.
Next, it says baggage door. Now,
this is for your baggage. There's a tow bar in the back there.
Only one purse, girls, can fit in here.
That's right.
How it goes. All right, so baggage door, we have to lock. I kind of give it a little nudge there, make sure it doesn't want to pop open. Now, got the baggage door. We're kind of moving along the side here, looking for any damage, holes. This has the way that they designed this is it's skin wrapped around a few like structural components, what we call bulkheads and stringers.
Right.
But there's not much. There's not like a skeleton of this thing wrapped around.
Really?
The skin is like the big structural component of the whole plane.
Right.
So if you had a big hole in the skin, you're compromised a lot on the strength of that.
No, wow, plane, that's right? Crazy.
So there's not like a skeleton, like when they wrap it. Some of the old planes, they wrapped them with fabric and they had this big, just kind of like metal skeleton in there.
Right.
Too heavy for, they can get away with keeping it like almost like a soda can.
Oh, for the smaller planes.
Yeah, for here, right?
Yeah.
What we're looking for is damage to the skin, you know, especially here where birds and rocks get hit the leading edge of the horizontal stabilizer here.
Say hello to the bird killer.
That's right. So we got the horizontal stabilizer and then we have our elevator, right? This is what gives us up or down movement. This is like our first flight control that we look at here. So what I do is I lift it up and down. I want to make sure that this thing has
this gives you how high you're going to fly or how low you're going to go.
Right. So okay. If I wanted to climb, I'm going to be pulling back on the yoke, right? My elevator is going to go like this.
Okay.
What's going to happen is air is traveling this up top of this horizontal stabilizer coming here, and it's going below, right? So what happens here is air hits this, wants to push it down.
Oh, brings your nose up.
Kicks the nose up.
Oh, like okay, cool.
When we go nice. Down, right, air is hitting from the bottom here and hitting it, and it's
push the nose down.
Yeah.
Nice. So that's all within your joystick, within your yoke. Like pushing it forward will make it.
Yeah, pushing it forward is going to go like this, right? And it's going to hit the tail up.
Right.
Pushing you down. And you'll see it. Now.
What's this called again? A stabilizer?
This is an elevator, and then this is a horizontal stabilizer.
Okay.
So this doesn't move.
Okay.
This is the part that moves.
Just horizontal like what?
Horizontal stabilizer.
And.
Elevator. So you got a horizontal stabilizer and a vertical stabilizer.
Okay.
Sort of like the mast and the
right,
like the
right.
T, and then you have flight controls off of that help you, that are attached to this to help deflect you depending on it's this movement of airflow and aligning itself up. Kind of like a ship, right?
Right.
If you have a rudder in the back, right, you're turning the wheel, it's deflecting in the water because you're moving through the water a certain way, and then now the water's hitting something, it's going to kick that thing out of the way and turn you.
Right, instead of water, this is air.
Air, yeah.
So, quick question. So, when you move the yoke, it controls both the rear flap and the front flaps?
So, the flaps are up, that's what we dropped right there.
Yeah.
You control that by that little electric
stick. Oh, the little lever, okay.
Yeah. Now, if you wanted to roll this way, right, that's when we turn the control yoke or control wheel. This way, that's going to move your aileron. Those are, I'm guessing that's what you're meaning by the flap. But those are on the end of the wing. So that's doing the same thing, right? Air is
pulling
across the top of the wing, and it actually hits that aileron.
So those are those end flaps right here.
Exactly.
All right, cool. Ailerons?
Ailerons, what we call them.
Nice.
So, yeah, if you're pulling back or pushing forward, it's working this. If you're turning the wheel, then it's working this.
Oh, okay. So when you go to fly, do you set those at a certain thing for the takeoff?
Is the flaps?
Is that later
normally
on?
Normally they're up. There are certain indications or certain situations if you want to take off sooner, you would have them down to a certain position to take off. But usually we use the flaps for landing because it adds drag to the aircraft.
Oh, okay.
So
later
you have
on.
Thrust, you have drag, and they're kind of fighting each other. So you probably, when you're taking off, you want to have the least amount of drag. You want that thing to take off, not be wanting to pull you back like friction.
Right.
So important thing on a control surface, right, is to make sure that this thing's going to be attached. So I always look, there's a nut and a bolt at the hinge that we want to make sure. Mm. Oh yeah, the nut's still on the bolt, you know, it didn't vibrate.
Right.
That'd be important, right? Also damage, you can tell that they corrugated these, and that's just basically for strength, right? If it was just flat, it's just sheet metal, you know, right. So it's not... It's kind of weak here, you see.
So but double sheet metal corrugated is strong,
right? Gives it that strength. I mean, you can see right here it kind of bends at the flat part, but here, man, it's like
right
strong. Now you don't need to have too much strength on the rudder itself. That's why it's just kind of flat. But this is, like we said, it's off that rudder pedals, and that helps our directional control. It controls where our nose points at.
Right.
Now, they have a little trim tab on here set, and we don't really set this. The mechanic will set this. There's inherent forces in the plane that want to turn the plane a certain direction, usually to the left, depending on, because, you know, the prop spins in a certain direction, and it creates asymmetrical thrust, so it wants to kind of pull you over to the left. So they might put in a right tendency for this thing to stick to the right or move a little bit more to the right so it keeps you from wanting to turn left. So
right, almost like a malalignment in a car.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
You're changing the camber and stuff with the tire so that you realign yourself. So we don't really adjust that. So when you're moving this surface, right, they don't want you to move as up here because we talked about it. It's flat. It just wants to bend. We don't, you can see some people have already touched it up here and put some dents in it and stuff because they're like pulled in. So what I tell people is if you're going to move it, you see there's like a rivet line that goes down here. So I just hold it down at the bottom here and it doesn't hurt anything. So I just take it through the full movement. I want to make sure that this thing isn't binding up or it's not like super loose to go there, move or deflect. And you can see there's cables that come back here, and that's what's pulling it. So, right, you pull one cable, other one loosens. And we just make sure, hey, it's got these little nuts and bolts, and it has a little cotter pin to kind of help it from backing off. Same with some safety wire here. Make sure that those aren't broken. Those are usually just gonna stop. Chain off of here because it won't go very far.
Not a very chain,
right? It'll be like, oh,
boss won't be mad, guys.
Right? Again, this is the other side. It's all one piece. It's off a tube that's in here, and there's a cable system that moves back.
Oh, okay.
It's all cables and pulleys.
So just going through now the right side check of it.
Exactly. So if we're looking. This is a trim tab that we have on here. This is something that we can't adjust inside there. And so pilots, we're kind of weak as, I would hate to like have to, you know, if you're driving along and you had to hold, you know, a right, you know, the wheel to the right, like you said, your alignment's off and now you have to basically have to drive the wheel to keep it straight. We have to hold it in, right?
Right.
We don't want to be doing that for a whole 3 hour, 4 hour flight.
Right, triceps are cramping up.
Yeah, you're like, no way. So we have trim that we can set, right? So if I wanted to trim it out, let's say we get up to straight and level flight, we're there, and then I'm gonna adjust the trim wheel so I don't even have to hold the yoke, right? It just wants to fly nice and straight.
Right.
So you'd have to be able to adjust this little trim tab, and that kind of sticks up depending on what you want, and it will keep you nice and flat inside there, depending on what forces you're trying to do. and he'll make more sense when we get up in the air.
So quick question, what are these things for? I see these all on the edges here.
Yeah, so these are called static wicks. And so as the plane moves through the air, it's like if you just took your socks off in the carpet, right? If you're doing that, you develop static electricity.
Right.
Anytime you're moving molecules across the surface, you're developing static electricity. Well, this plane in particular, that static electricity that's built up on the surface of the wing goes into the radios. And then the radios will suck.
Nice.
So what they do is they want to get the static electricity off of the airframe. And so what they do is they transfer it out to these little static wicks. And you'll see there's these little metal sort of grounding strips that come in through. So all the development of static electricity goes in through here, in through this little thing out to the tip that trails off.
Oh, wow, nice. Just while you're in flight.
So
then that helps you have good radio.
Yeah, because that static
communication
will build up in the radio and it'll be
right.
Static.
What'd you say? Shit on your turning.
It'll build up into the thing. It's like, you know, you ground everything into the airframe and stuff. So if you're building up electricity, it kind of sucks.
Right.
So these are what we call the VOR, or navigation antennas, in the back. And you'll learn more about those when we're going out and doing some instrument stuff.
Okay.
But basically, you can pick up and you can basically navigate off a radio signal. So that's one of the antennas that's on there.
So you got 5G when you
right.
Get on the plane.
Well,
he basically has a 5G on a 1970s aircraft.
1970s 5G. Next, we got the ELT. Remember we talked about that? That's an emergency locator transmitter.
Right.
We got a unit inside here, kind of like an accelerometer on your phone. You know, if you move it, it'll show the movement. Basically, when we hit the ground, if we hit the ground, that thing comes out of its cradle and it hits the back wall. And then it activates that unit. And
it's like a SOS beacon.
Exactly.
Right.
So that crashes, that thing comes out of its cradle, hits the wall, and that impact activates it, and it will send out a signal on one of the frequencies going whoop, whoop, whoop. So anybody flying around, they'll go, and they're monitoring that frequency, will go, hey, I got an ELT in this location, so then they'll send people to pinpoint
right. The
crash. Down here is another comm antenna, kind of an older comm antenna.
Not 5G, guys.
Not 5G. Transponder antenna.
Dial up. AOL right there.
Right, yeah. This is like old school DSL.
If you call us while we're flying this thing, this is what you're going to get. It's going to sound like a fax machine.
Then we have our comm antennas up here. There's two. Obviously newer ones. That's how we talk on the radio. We actually have two radios in here. One we listen to, like the weather frequency, and you can pick up other frequencies too. You monitor it. The other one you're actually the one that you're main one you're listening to, and then when you cue up the mic, you're actually talking.
Cool.
We got a right flap here. And really looking for damage to this thing. Damage, holes, that's off its track. And what I do is I'll lift it up and down. There should be a little bit of movement. And I go side to side. I don't want a lot of, you know, damage to this thing. It's on these tracks. And they're just little rollers. And they just follow along the track here. And it's just a little push rod. So there's a little electric motor inside here, and it drives both of them. There's just one motor on one side, and then it's got a little gear, and it links the two together, and then it puts it out, and then increments that you put on the switch there.
Right.
And it's just a little push rod. So what I check is I make sure, hey, each of these has a bolt and a nut, just like our elevators, right? And then this little rod pushes the flaps in, or it sucks it out, and it has a little jam nut on here, so I just make sure that thing's not
not gonna fall apart. Then we get to our ailerons. Like we said, this helps with the roll, so you can see the control. See, if I want to turn right, this is gonna go up.
Oh wow, yeah, okay. Right?
If I go the other side, that one goes up, this one goes down.
Do that again.
So up, that one's down, this one's up. So if I'm turning to the right, and if I want to turn to the left,
oh wow, okay. Nice, so they work simultaneously.
Simultaneously, they're all linked together with.
Right, okay.
So you want one wing to drop and one wing to raise.
I wonder if like the F-16s are this simple, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah, it's every plane is gonna have pretty much some flight controls, right? So they're gonna have an aileron, something to lift and raise wings, and then lift and raise noses, right?
So right.
Pitch up and pitch down, roll left, roll right, and have some sort of directional stability of where to point your nose, because we all move in three different directions. So yeah, the F-16 and an F-22 would all be the same.
Nice.
Have the same stuff. They might have spoilers and other kind of things.
A little high tech, yeah.
Yeah, but for the most part, they're gonna have the simple, basic flight controls. Now, these ones are a little bit different. They have hinges, right? So really what we're looking at is the hinge pins, making sure the hinge, there's a pin that goes through all of those, so make sure those aren't backed out. And again, this is just a push rod with a little rod end. And like I said, it's a little cable system with a pulley and it just pushes out. So we just check and make sure those are all good. This is our wing tip. This is usually made out of fiberglass. It is in a metal.
Like nice. Metal.
So it's like a formed fiberglass. So that whole thing kind of comes off here.
Right.
And it obviously has our light stuff. A lot of people ask what this little thing is. We call that a light spike. So if it's nighttime, right, it's kind of like an old school fiber optic. If it's nighttime, you can't tell if your green light's on. Well, yeah, you can, because that light will shine on here, and it's just like a little...
Oh, okay, cool. Like, yeah, like a little submarine, like telescope looking thing.
Yeah, like it's like a fiber, like an old school, you know, those fiber optic trees and stuff.
Right, right.
The light travels along that little plastic piece. And so while you're sitting in the cockpit, you can look out here and this little stick will be glowing green.
Nice.
You'll know, hey, that light's on.
Oh, okay, cool.
Because you're going to be able to tell.
I thought you said I was going to have to climb out in the plane in the middle of the night while we're flying.
You're like, is it on?
Shimmy out there on the wing and check that light, man. Go and give it a couple knocks.
It would be me because you're having to fly.
No, it would be me because I'm the student.
Then we got the leading edge of the wing here. Obviously, this is going to take the biggest brunt of all the air. So
right.
If a bird's going to hit, it's going to hit on one of the forward surfaces here. So we look for dents, cracks. As you can see, we hit all the bugs. Doing our part here.
Nice, I see a couple little holes here. Is there a purpose for those?
So these are for the vents, right? We got some fresh air vents. We don't really have AC on the plane. It's gonna be just fresh air going in.
But I mean, when you're like hundreds of feet above the earth, you know, it's not really.
Yeah, 5,000 feet is a little bit.
Yeah, it's like just chilled, nice 70, sunny,
yeah,
you know.
It's comfy. Yeah, sometimes it's like 32 degrees, so that's when you get cabin heat.
Hopefully you brought your Carhartt.
Right, exactly. So, you can tell it's a big old wing, man. It's sticking out there. So, they need to support it somehow, so they have this wing strut here to help support the wing. Because if you didn't have anything, that thing would be sticking way out there. There's not a lot of support. It's unlike you see the low wings over there, the Pipers?
Right, okay, yeah.
They don't have a wing strut. It's actually a spar. It's internally braced inside there. So they'll have basically an I-beam going through here. But this one, we don't really have a long I-beam. They just use these wing struts here to help support. And there'd be tie downs on here, right? We're just really looking for damage. I kind of rocked it back and forth, make sure that thing's still attached on there. We're gonna take that little cup and we'll drain this side.
Well, he said we gotta do a double shot, guys.
Double shot.
Blue.
Blue, no water.
No water.
Good. All right, we'll dump it.
Oh, you gotta drink it. Here you go.
Yeah, it's my turn.
Yeah, it's your turn. Cheers, Maddie.
And the same thing, right? Right tire. Same thing we're looking for. Damage to the tire, proper inflation, brakes looking okay, not a lot of drain.
Cool.
Move it out. Sweet.
Sweet.
All right, we're heading on our way here. We're gonna hop up and check and see the tanks if you want to hop up.
Okay, we're gonna hop up. We'll be back.
Okay, I'll kind of go quick here. So inside here, there's a little dipstick that twists in there.
Right.
Right. And so basically,
this is checking the oil, right? Oil,
right. So you can see. Let's see. There's a, so you see how there's a 6 on here.
Yeah.
And a 4. So we just kind of look. Usually you want it somewhere in between the 6 and the 4.
Okay.
So as long as it's in between the 6 and the 4, you're golden.
Nice.
If it's right at 4,
add a
little bit above, add a quarter. Usually I keep it around 5, so somewhere in the halfway mark seems pretty good. And you can see it looks like the oil just got changed. It's pretty
nice. Yeah, dude. Yeah.
It looks clean.
It's fresh.
So we just pop that back in there and twist it on. Now, if we did need to add oil, you saw there's one in there. You just pulled the stick out, put the funnel in, dump the whole thing in. There's also what we call a fuel strainer right here. I don't know if you can see, you can feel it. It's a little square.
Oh, okay, I feel it, yeah.
So you're gonna put your fingers around there and it's gonna piss out fuel at the bottom. That comes out the strainer. You don't really need to catch it. You just pull that thing open. Yeah, just pull it out.
Can I push it back or what?
Yeah, pull it out.
Nice.
So that's a little strainer bowl. So the fuel comes from the fuel selector into that strainer. It's just a little cup, and that's where the filter is, this little fuel filter. So the fuel's got to go through the fuel filter and then up and then into the carburetor. So that kind of helps with any of the sediment and crap that would get in there. Well, that sediment would get on the filter and then it would just fall into the bottom of the bowl. So that's what we do, is we pull that little strainer. This is all that crap out.
Oh, nice. Okay.
Out of the ground.
Instead of getting caught up in your engine.
Instead of going to the engine. One of the lines of defense. So, oil, dipstick, and the fuel strainer's in there. We just make sure that the little access is closed.
Is there how long you should open that strainer up to empty it, or just like a quick little...
Some guys try to like grab the tub and they end up getting full of fuel. So I'm like, if they wanted you to catch it, they would have made it easier for you.
Yeah.
So, you can catch it. I mean, if you're getting stuff in there, sometimes guys reach out. I usually run it for a second or two.
Okay.
That's enough to purge all that. It's a little tiny bowl.
Right.
It's not even... Plus, I don't like dumping.
Right, yeah. So, I mean, it says 363 a gallon, so, you know.
That's a hard time to start.
Yeah, it's... Anyways.
So we'll keep going down really quick here. So then we kind of move down here. We check the exhaust and I flick it, right? So I hear that ring. If it was not working, right? If it's broken, it'd be like a, you'd think that it's broken up at the top there.
Oh, okay, cool.
Make sure that this thing isn't broken because it goes into an exhaust manifold up there. I flick it, I hear the ring. I would think it's pretty solid. Then you have your nose strut here. So we just make sure that that's got a little bit of inflation in there because that's going to provide some of our
shock
absorption. Yeah. Tire, same thing as we talk on the mains, right? You got like a little bolt going through there, and then there's the fork of the nose. And then you have a shimmy damper here. It basically helps with, you know, you get the speed wobbles on a bike.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of helps with the oscillations on that. So. Make sure that that's looking good. Everything looking good on there. We go up to the prop, right? So it's just one piece of metal going through. We call this a fixed pitch prop. Obviously there's one leading edge. This is the direction that it spins. So this is where any rock's gonna hit usually. So what I do is I run my hand along the edge here to make sure that there's no nicks inside here, because if there's a nick, right, these things spin around so fast that
forces on the outer part here, is it's moving so quick, it could actually stress it and break a tip off, you know.
Oh.
if you're spinning, if there was a huge stick inside here. So I kind of run my hand along the side just to make sure that there's nothing
really on there.
Feels like a sword, bro.
Same thing over here. Check that. Spinner basically covers, helps the airflow go across and then into the forks. Kind of check and make sure screws are on there. These are your cooling inlets. You can see the engines inside here. Air flows over them, cools the engine. There's not like a coolant system on your car. It's all air cooled. So air is gonna flow in there. And I just check, make sure there's no like squirrels or birds or anything inside there. And that looks pretty good. Obviously landing light. And then this is your air filter for the engine. So this goes right into the carburetor, up in the carburetor. So we just make sure that that's not blocked by anything. It's got like an oily residue.
Right.
But
that's what I noticed.
If you're about 80% clogged, then you'd be like, oh shoot, we need to change something.
Yeah, yeah, it's gonna so, boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, they ain't getting too much air. It's
nice.
Then we move along this side. This is our static port. We just make sure that a little hole remains open. There shouldn't be a little bug or anything inside there. Again, leading edge, our little cooling vents, pitot tube. This is our stall indication. So we'll go to a certain pitch up, right? Eventually, your plane's not going to be able to create as much lift as it is, right? The air flowing over the wing is going to start breaking off up the top of the wing, and now you're going to destroy your lift. So what happens is as you get to that point, that stall horn's gonna go off and it's gonna make an oral noise inside the cockpit. It's gonna go, right? And it's telling you, hey, you're about to stall the plane for the wing. You have to lose our lift. So we actually practice stalls as one of the maneuvers. We bring it all the way to a full stall and let that thing.
Wow, nice.
Okay, we got our fuel vent right here. So ports of venting the fuel, right? It's all gravity fed. Well, what happens is you get at the top of the fuel, and so, you know, as you're draining down, guess where you're just creating a vacuum at the top of the fuel.
Right.
And now it's eventually gonna, that vacuum the suction pressure is just gonna hold the fuel up there. So we gotta vent the top of the fuel. So that's our fuel vent. So we just make sure there's nothing in there, nothing in the pitot tube. Little bugs like to get in there and make a little
mission guys.
Yeah, exactly. And then the same thing, right? We look at the aileron, wingtip, make sure we got all the hinges and the last thing we'll do up here is you already checked the fuel. I'll check the fuel on this side.
Hey, don't drink it, bro. Don't drink it.
Right.
There's water somewhere. I don't see water out here, but I know there's water somewhere.
We've got about
17,
18 gallons, plenty for what we're
going to do. Awesome. Is this complete
the
pre-check? Pre-check complete, guys.
So just a quick passenger brief. Just like a regular aircraft, right? All we're gonna do is lift this handle right here. Seatbelt comes off if we do need to get out for any reason, right? Shoulder harness is the same. Coming out here is a button. Door, you just lift the handle up and push out, right? Easy.
Jump!
If we did need to get off there, okay? Window could be the same. There's a little handle right there and it'll pop open.
Oh, right here?
Yeah.
Got it.
That way you get a little air breeze.
Oh.
All right, if there was a fire, right, we're gonna basically continue cranking, try to get the engine started. If there's like an engine fire, if we couldn't get it started and it's just burning, right, we're just gonna turn everything off. We're gonna exit. There's no fire extinguisher in here. Nearest one's out on the fuel island right by the fuel prices there. We ain't gonna fight it. We're not firefighters, so we're just gonna burn insurance, bro. For
upgrade.
Yep, and then basically no smoking,
if we're listening on the radio, we'll try not to talk. And then just positive exchange of controls, because you'll be flying, and then I'll say, oh yeah, my control, so then you kind of like your controls, and we make sure each other, okay, yeah, your controls. So not both of us are trying to fly at the same time, and then not nobody's flying at the same time. So that's basically the passenger brief. All right, so we're here. We just did the passenger brief. Pre-flight is complete. We did all that. Seat belts are on and secure. Fuel selector valve says in the both position. Radios, electric equipment is all off. Brakes, we're gonna hold. So go ahead and push the top of the brakes there, and we'll hold them. And you don't have to be like that. It's all good. Circuit breakers are all in. So we're using our circuit breakers. Now we're gonna start the engine. So go ahead and put your mixture in rich.
So this is your mixture?
Yeah, that's our mixture. Yep, that's how much fuel we add in. Perfect.
Like that?
Yep. Cool. Mixture's in. Carburetor heat's cold. So carb heat, if we wanted it hot, we'd have it pulled out. But we're going to have it cold, so it's going to be pushed in.
When do you use this? Just when it's cold outside?
When it's cold outside, you got visible moisture. It could be, you can develop carb ice, though, even when it's 70 degrees and humid, right? It's that air moisture is getting in that carburetor and it's getting cool from the Venturi. So we use that usually when we're pulling power back to idle and we're coming into land, and we'll pop the carb heat on if it's not too hot. All right, master switch on. So go ahead and hit the master switch on, that red switch. Sweet. All right, we're gonna go ahead and prime because this is the first flight of the day. There's a primer over to the left side there, so you're just gonna rotate it until it, that little, there's like a little nub on the actual shaft of that thing, and it will, yeah, so now it's coming out. Can you pull it out?
Oh, I gotta pull it out?
Yeah, so there'll be like a, yeah, there you go. See how there's like a little
like
key
a,
on there? Yeah.
A little nipple.
Yeah, a little nipple, and it has to line up, so go ahead and push that in. That's gonna pump fuel into the cylinder, so we'll do that like 2 times. And then make sure it goes in there and turn it, and then yeah, now make sure it's locked. All right, throttle, we're gonna open. So this is our throttle. If we wanna go full throttle, like we're taking off. Dang, someone's got that thing locked. Damn. Basically, it's pretty stiff, but if you wanna go full throttle, that's full throttle. If you wanna go to idle, we're pulling out. Just like you're like, advance the throttle to go fast, right? So basically what it says is it wants to be, so it's saying right here, throttle open to 1/8 inch. So 1/8 inch is barely anything, it's just cracked, just like that. Beacon and nav light, so go ahead and put your beacon light on.
This is beacon?
Yep, beacon. And nav, yeah.
Okay.
We're gonna grab the keys. Obviously the black one's gonna be the one that runs the engine, so we're gonna put that in the key slot there. All right, then we're gonna look around, make sure no one's head's under the prop, no one's walking up. Then we're gonna yell out clear prop, so if you wanna yell that one out.
Clear prop!
Okay, and then let's go ahead and turn the key to the start position. You're gonna hold it there until it turns. Good. Started.
Nice. She sounds like a 1970s.
There we go.
Oil pressure's coming up. That looks good. Oil tube will obviously rise up. Everything else looks good. And it's basically right where we want it, right about 1,000 RPM. Go ahead and flip the avionics switch on. That switch, yeah.
Our headsets on.
Thank you.